Hello guys, this is Leo the Wise, giving to all men, their needed uprise.
Dear men, dear MGTOWs, this is the following part of an article from MGTOW.com sharing Arthur Schopenhauer's view on females and female nature. Schopenhauer on Women, c. 1865, Part 2. But women are by no means conscious of this leading principle in abstract too, they are only conscious of it in concreto, and have no other way of expressing it than in the manner in which they act when the opportunity arrives. So that their conscience does not trouble them so much as we imagine, for in the darkest depths of their hearts they are conscious that in violating their duty towards the individual they have all the better fulfilled it towards the species, whose claim upon them is infinitely greater. Because women in truth exist entirely for the propagation of the race, and their destiny ends here, they live more for the species than for the individual, and in their hearts take the affairs of the species more seriously than those of the individual. This gives to their whole being and character a certain frivolousness, and altogether a certain tendency which is fundamentally different from that of man. And this it is which develops that discord in married life which is so prevalent and almost the normal state. It is natural for a feeling of mere indifference to exist between men, but between women it is actual enmity. This is due perhaps to the fact that odium figulinum in the case of men is limited to their everyday affairs, but with women embraces the whole sex. Since they have only one kind of business, even when they meet in the street, they look at each other like Guelphs and Ghibellines. And it is quite evident when two women first make each other acquaintance that they exhibit more constraint and dissimulation than two men placed in similar circumstances. This is why an exchange of compliments between two women is much more ridiculous than between two men. Further, while a man will, as a rule, address others, even those inferior to himself, with a certain feeling of consideration and humanity, it is unbearable to see how proudly and disdainfully a lady of rank will, for the most part, behave towards one who is in a lower rank not employed in her service when she speaks to her. This may be because differences of rank are much more precarious with women than with us, and consequently more quickly change their line of conduct and elevate them, or because while a hundred things must be weighed in our case, there is only one to be weighed in theirs, namely, with which man they have found favor. And again, because of the one-sided nature of their vocation they stand in closer relationship to each other than men do. And so it is they try to render prominent the differences of rank. It is only the man whose intellect is clouded by his sexual instinct that could give that stunted, narrow-shouldered, broad-hipped, and short-legged race the name of the fair sex. For the entire beauty of the sex is based on this instinct. One would be more justified in calling them the unaesthetic sex than the beautiful. Neither for music, nor for poetry, nor for fine art have they any real or true sense and susceptibility, and it is mere mockery on their part, in their desire to please, if they affect any such thing. This makes them incapable of taking a purely objective interest in anything, and the reason for it is, I fancy, as follows. A man strives to get direct mastery over things either by understanding them or by compulsion. But a woman is always and everywhere driven to indirect mastery, namely through a man, all her direct mastery being limited to him alone. Therefore it lies in woman nature to look upon everything only as a means for winning man, and her interest in anything else is always a simulated one, a mere roundabout way to gain her ends, consisting of coquetry and pretense. Hence Rousseau said, Les femmes, NGL, animent aucun art, ni se connaissent aucun et NNT aucun G. Letter D. Lambert, note XX. Everyone who can see through a sham must have found this to be the case. One need only watch the way they behave at a concert, the opera, or the play. The childish simplicity, for instance, with which they keep on chattering during the finest passages in the greatest masterpieces. If it is true that the Greeks forbade women to go to the play, they acted in a right way. For they would at any rate be able to hear something. In our day it would be more appropriate to substitute tacit muelleria in theatro for tacit muelleria in ecclesia. and this might perhaps be put up in big letters on the curtain. Nothing different can be expected of women if it is borne in mind that the most eminent of the whole sex have never accomplished anything in the fine arts that is really great, genuine, and original, or given to the world any kind of work of permanent value. This is most striking in regard to painting, the technique of which is as much within their reach as within ours. This is why they pursue it so industriously. Still, they have not a single great painting to show, for the simple reason that they lack that objectivity of mind which is precisely what is so directly necessary in painting. They always stick to what is subjective. For this reason, ordinary women have no susceptibility for painting at all, for natural non-facet seldom. And Hort, in his book which has been famous for 300 years, examined De Ingenios para las Ciencias, contends that women do not possess the higher capacities. Individual and partial exceptions do not alter the matter. Women are and remain, taken altogether, the most thorough and incurable Philistines. And because of the extremely absurd arrangement which allows them to share the position and title of their husbands, they are a constant stimulus to his ignoble ambitions. And further, it is because they are Philistines that modern society, to which they give the tone and where they have sway, has become corrupted. As regards their position, one should be guided by Napoleon maxim, les femmes en antipode de rang. And regarding them in other things, Chamfort says very truly, elles sont faites pour commercer avec nos faiblesses avec notre folie, mais non avec notre raison. Il existe entre elles et les hommes des sympathies de pédermatier pu de sympathies de spredimi et de correct e. They are the sexus sequior, the second sex in every respect, therefore their weaknesses should be spared, but to treat women with extreme reverence is ridiculous, and lowers us in their own eyes. When nature divided the human race into two parts, she did not cut it exactly through the middle. The difference between the positive and negative poles, according to polarity, is not merely qualitative but also quantitative, and it was in this light that the ancients and people of the East regarded woman. They recognized her true position better than we, with our old French ideas of gallantry and absurd veneration, that highest product of Christian Teutonic stupidity. These ideas have only served to make them arrogant and imperious, to such an extent as to remind one at times of the holy apes and banners, who, in the consciousness of their holiness and inviolability, think they can do anything and everything they please. In the West, the woman, that is to say the lady, finds herself in a false position. For woman, rightly named by the ancient sexus sequior, is by no means fit to be the object of our honor and veneration, or to hold her head higher than man and to have the same rights as he. The consequences of this false position are sufficiently clear. Accordingly, it would be a very desirable thing if this number two of the human race in Europe were assigned her natural position, and the lady grievance got rid of, which is not only ridiculed by the whole of Asia, but would have been equally ridiculed by Greece and Rome. The result of this would be that the condition of our social, civil, and political affairs would be incalculably improved. The Salic law would be unnecessary. It would be a superfluous truism. The European lady, strictly speaking, is a creature who should not exist at all. But there ought to be housekeepers, and young girls who hope to become such. And they should be brought up not to be arrogant, but to be domesticated and submissive. It is exactly because there are ladies in Europe that women of a lower standing, that is to say, the greater majority of the sex, are much more unhappy than they are in the East. Even Lord Byron says, Letters and Papers, by Thomas More, vol. E. pages 399, thought of the state of women under the ancient Greeks convenient enough. Present state, a remnant of the barbarism of the chivalric and feudal ages, artificial and unnatural. They ought to mind home and be well fed and clothed but not mixed in society. Well educated, too, in religion but to read neither poetry nor politics, nothing but books of piety and cookery. Music, drawing, dancing, also a little gardening and plowing now and then. I have seen them mending the roads in Epirus with good success. Why not, as well as hay making and milking? In our part of the world, where monogamy is in force, to marry means to have one rights and to double one duties. When the laws granted woman the same rights as man, they should also have given her a masculine power of reason. On the contrary, Just as the privileges and honors which the laws decree to women surpass what nature has meted out to them, so is there a proportional decrease in the number of women who really share these privileges. Therefore the remainder are deprived of their natural rights insofar as the others have been given more than nature accords.
And that is it for now. If this content was entertaining and interested you, please share, like, and subscribe to this channel. I am the Swan, leading men till dawn, and even beyond. Thanks for the audience.